Okay, good. Oh, okay.
Now we are. Give me a second.
Okay.
Here we go.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm going to hit Joe, and I'll go like this when it's time. Okay. All right. Hi, welcome back to another week of On the Town. I'm your host, Tanya Cooper, and this week we have a special guest. After nearly 40 years of performing as a clinical psychologist, he retired at 65 years old, and at 80, he began performing comedy. He was featured in the New York, in the Daily News, won the Funniest Jewish Comic Contest in 2016, and he has been featured and headlined in many shows at major comedy clubs in the tri-state area, and he does comedy coaching. Please welcome George Saltz. Hey, George.
Hey, Tanya.
How are you?
Good.
That's good. I'm trying to see you. Give me a second here.
Can you see me?
Yep.
Okay. I see
you're,
me.
You're there.
Okay.
I just have
is it a good enough picture? Okay.
Yes, it's a fabulous.
Is that better? Oh,
there you go. All right. So okay. How's it going in the world of Corona? How are you doing?
Good.
Yeah?
Sorry? What?
In the world of Corona, how are you doing?
Considering I'm doing okay.
All right.
You know, Zooms and everything else.
I know. I'd be looking at the Zooms like, oh my God, people. Hey. So that's good. It's a good thing.
Yeah.
So
I miss live shows so much.
It's, I know. Everybody does.
Nothing like it.
No. Do you get to perform where you're at?
No.
Okay. All right.
I have in the past, but I'm not doing it now.
Here. Okay. I hear you. So
I would have to do it with masks, you know.
That takes away the whole purpose. Like, you
really,
know, yeah, you can't do no act outs. I mean, that's, yeah. It's a weird time, but I'm learning that, you know, I'm just going to have to work this Zoom thing as much as we can, right?
Exactly.
So you were featured as Funniest Jewish Comic Contest in 2016?
Yep.
That's amazing. How many people were trying out for this thing?
Well, do you want to know what I say in my routine?
What's
true?
Yeah.
Routine, I say it's not as impressive as it sounds.
Uh-huh.
Because the finals just had three finalists, myself and two Muslims.
Okay.
And one of them, you couldn't hear what he said behind the burqa.
Oh.
But I think it was the 18th or 19th year of the contest.
Uh-huh.
And it's quite a plum. I'm pretty proud of it.
Nice, nice.
It's sponsored by the Jewish Voice, a newspaper.
Okay.
And quite a few of your well-known comics entered it, and they boasted at the time they came in second, they came in third.
Uh-huh.
But to come in first is quite good.
Absolutely. And you started comedy at 80?
Yeah.
Wow. Please tell
actually,
us about that.
I started at 18. I was always on.
Okay.
You know, I was always the class clown and
entertained
in high school. Yeah, you know. But I performed in the Catskills, actually. I was good enough to get hired for the Catskills at 18.
Wow.
But I had stage fright, and I got fired.
Okay.
And I made a promise I'd be back.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept the promise. 62 years later, I was back.
It's like, I'm back. I'm like, who the hell are you?
I got sooner or later.
I'm really funny now.
It really.
Wow.
It's. I love it. Mm-hmm. Really, very, very pleased with it.
Well, so that was when you were what 16? That was the first time you thought you
18,
were funny.
Yeah.
18. 18.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But do you remember your first joke?
I'm sorry?
Do you remember your first joke?
Ever?
Ever.
Yes. I was 10 years old,
mm-hmm.
and the dentist asked me if I wanted to be a dentist
mm-hmm.
when I grew up.
Mm-hmm.
And I was 10 or 12. I don't really remember.
Mm-hmm.
And I said no. And he said, why? I said, because dentists live from hand to mouth. That was my very first joke.
So you were clever already, huh?
Even then, I was a smartass. Yeah. You know what's interesting about that in terms of jokes? I had heard my mother talking about neighbors
mm-hmm.
describing them that they were poor, mm-hmm. and they lived from hand to mouth. Oh. And somehow that term stuck with me. Mm. You know, just as a kid, it sounded very strange. Mm-hmm. And apparently I must have filed it away. And then when the appropriate time came, mm-hmm. When they asked me with the dentist, I somehow I remembered that. Mm-hmm. And I connected, you know, A and B and had a joke. And it's a lot what I do. I can relate old kinds of things. I have like a Google Mind like file.
Well, hello, yeah.
Of remembering things, and then it just clicks. Even when I was taking a comedy course, I took at 79. I took a comedy course with Dave LaBarca. Okay. And one of the I wasn't hip to the new terms, you know, obviously. Mm-hmm. And one of the female students was talking about being on the train and every time she moved and you know, gesticulated with her hand, she hit the guy in the junk. And I didn't know what that meant. You know, so I said, well, you know, what is that? And so she told me, you know, it's the, you know, the genital area. And I filed that away. And I used it as a joke because in my day, they called it the family jewels.
That's right.
And so it was grist for the mill. You know, I just, you know, said, going back to when I was younger, and, you know, the teacher in the gym said, boys, when you go up for the basketball, you got to protect the family jewels. And I was so proud. He called them my family jewels. My family jewels. And what do they call it now? Junk. What the hell happened? You know, and then I just riff on that. But it was the same kind of process that I used when I was 10 or 12 years old somehow. I get fascinated, you know, which is, you know, I just observe things. And I if something strikes my mind, it gets sort of recorded. And then at the appropriate time, I will, you know, connect it, you know, to some kind of joke that way.
That's great. I forgot what we'd call that in school, comedy school. You store a nugget or something for later. So something might come up now, but it doesn't fit with my set. So
This is what, you know, they always tell you, you know, anything, when you get an idea, just write it down.
Right. Exactly.
And, now you know, you may use it later. And that's certainly true.
Wow. That's amazing.
But I have a lot of things that over all these years, obviously I didn't write it down because, you know, I wasn't, you know, I didn't even write down my notes as a psychologist.
Wow.
Don't tell anyone. But I was able to store it, and I was very, very, very pleased to do that.
Yeah. So you were a psychologist, which to me is interesting to make a transition to comedy because that means you already have a memory packet up there up somewhere. I think a good comic is not only memory, but being able to process all the information into something to make it into a joke. So because you're a psychologist, you understand the mind. So I think you have a little bit of an advantage.
Yeah, I think so. I think, in essence, the real advantage I have is my age in that sense, because, you know, you're exposed to so much more of life and experiences.
Yes.
So, and my sense of humor actually was something that I was afraid to use as a therapist at the beginning. Mm-hmm. I felt it was disrespectful to the patient.
Okay.
To you know, hear the patient was coming in trouble and pain, and that you know, for me to see, you know, make some kind of joke out of it was not right. And I can't tell you how many times, it doesn't mean I didn't think of the funny things,
right,
but I had to, you know, bite my tongue and you know, just not say it.
Yes.
But as I got more proficient and more experienced, I did use humor because it was a wonderful tool at the appropriate time.
Exactly.
Once you, you get to really know the patient and you get their respect.
Right. Exactly.
That from the patient that you're in their corner. Mm-hmm. So it's a most valuable tool.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I used to do addiction counseling, and I had a thing too that I didn't bring that to the stage because I just felt like it was, I don't know, I felt like it was a weird violation of some sort. So, but if I was sitting with clients and we were, if I thought I could break through to them through something and with humor, then of course I'd use it, but I would never go on stage and, you know, put stuff out there. And
yeah.
It was very easy, but I would never do it just because it's too cliche. And
I'll give you two examples. One, when I wasn't doing it, I was thinking funny, but I wasn't doing it. Uh-huh. And one when I did it many, many years later. The first time, I got a call from the woman that became my wife. She wasn't at the time. And she called me one morning. And early in the morning, she said, "Did you hear the terrible news?" And I said, "What?" She said, "Robert Kennedy was assassinated."
Wow.
And we spoke, yeah, we spoke for a half hour and so on. It was terrible. I hang up. I get a next call from a patient's wife. Mm-hmm. And she said, "Did you hear the wonderful news?" And I'm wondering, what the hell? I said, "This woman isn't mean. She's not, you know, nasty or anything. You know," I said, what's the wonderful news? Mm-hmm. She said, "Sammy got an erection." Her husband got an erection. That was the good news. So the comic in me wanted to say, well, one up and one down.
Oh, no.
But there's no way I would have said it, obviously. But so it just gives you an idea that even when I'm in the, you know, therapeutic situation, mm-hmm. I didn't shut off the comedy. It was there. And I can give you many, many other instances. Mm-hmm. Now, years later, I did it, and I would do it even to patients that were seriously depressed. Mm-hmm. At the appropriate time, I would be able to insert humor, and it gives them a lot of messages. You know, there's a time to laugh and a time to enjoy. There's light at the end of the tunnel, mm-hmm. You know, just to get a perspective on things. Mm-hmm. And So there was one, and it was a very serious, situation, and she had really good reason to be seriously upset, mm-hmm. and was just, and I, she'd been in therapy with me for a long time, mm-hmm. And she was just saying how she's so sorry she came, and, you know, 15 years, and you didn't help me, and just everything, and you're not going to help me, and nothing's going to happen, it's mm-hmm. hopeless, and so on. And as the session ended, as I got up, some coins fell out of my chair. You know, I had one of those fancy plush chairs. Okay. And she looked at me as the coins fell out, and I said, "You see, I told you there'd be change in therapy." And she smiled because we had been through so many wars before, mm-hmm. you know, and all of that. So we had a history, you know, we had a journey,
right.
And we were together. And I had the right, mm-hmm. if I saw humor in something, to get her to see the humor in it as well.
Absolutely.
But if you're doing that, you know, without really knowing or respecting the patient, then it's...
It becomes something else, yeah.
It's wrong, and it's really very, very valuable.
Yes. Who was your favorite comedian, or who is your favorite comedian?
Is and was are two different things.
Okay. Top three. Top three.
Okay, I just got to give you a handful, obviously.
Okay.
the biggest influence and were the Marx Brothers.
Oh, wow.
Growing up.
Okay.
Just everything. Just it begins and ends with them. Mm-hmm. Delivery, everything.
Yeah.
And then I was a child of radio, so I heard Fred Allen, mm-hmm. who most people don't know, mm-hmm. who I'm talking about, mm-hmm. Who was a tremendous wordsmith, mm-hmm. and humorist. And of course, you know, everyone on radio, I heard all of them and learned from them. And then Alan King and Robert Klein, mm. and Robin Williams, just a multitude of them. I love Dave Chappelle. You know, it's hard to know where to stop with them. They're all tremendous. Buddy Hackett, everyone. They're just wonderful clowns. Mm.
And what advice would you give someone who wanted to get into comedy that maybe, I say older like us, I'm 55, and I got in late as well. I just started 5 years ago. So you see those little 19-year-olds on stage, butting it out, hitting like 5 mics a night, you're like, whoa, I'm envious of that. But but I was like, I'm determined. One day I want to be the queen of late night TV, and I don't care how I get there. So I got into it because my teacher at Manhattan Comedy School told me, the only way to get a late night TV show is to do stand up. So I was like, well, no problem. I've been writing, but I didn't know. I didn't do stand up because I wasn't really, you know, I wasn't all that thrilled with it. I like being on stage, but to telling one liner jokes, not so much. So I'm still working on the craft of shortening, especially if it's a male audience. You know how you guys don't like too much detail. So I'm working on that, and I'm determined. But I also believe that there's always an audience for everyone. So just because you don't do what I do doesn't mean it's wrong.
You know, whether you're young or old, I would say open mics. I at 80, mm-hmm. I did 4 mics a week, 5 mm-hmm. mics a week.
I drove in
from Westchester, and I shouldn't have been driving. You know, I drive like Mr. Magoo now. my night driving really is, anyway. But I did drive. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I went into the comic strip, and I went into the Metropolitan Room.
Oh, yeah, and, I did that one.
I did the New York Comedy Club. And then up here in Westchester, you know, I did a couple of them, the Turning Point. Mm-hmm. And, of course, where I met you at right. Lucy's.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't do enough of that. It's really, that's your training ground.
That is.
And that's where you do it. And the younger kids, God bless them, they were going. There were 2 of them at the Metropolitan Room, and the second one was at 11 o'clock, and I couldn't, especially. And then to drive home, I wouldn't do that.
Right.
But a lot of them waited till the 11 o'clock show, mm-hmm. and then they went to the East, whatever was the Laughing Buddha, and so on. They would do 4 a night, so on. And that's really what you got to do. And this is like Osama, I think you know him, Badek. He would do about 4 or 6 a night, and now he's God bless him, he's way up there.
Yeah.
He's on the Colbert Show, I believe, and just it's just wonderful to see some of it pay off.
Yeah.
There's no guarantee, but I would say if you don't have the passion, mm-hmm. get out.
That's right.
It has to be passionate.
Yes.
You have to it, in dollars and cents, it's not going to pay off.
No.
You know, very few people.
No.
You know, unless you get your own show and so on. So it's like any other artist. You know, it's you got to do it for the love of it, and that's why so many people drop out. A lot of them come back,
right.
6 years later and 12 years later,
right.
and so on. But if you're going to stick with it, or even if you come back, the second time. Well, Chappelle dropped out all that time also, and he came back.
Oh, wow.
He walked away from...
The $50
million? $50
million. Oh, that, I remember, but I thought he still was performing on the ground, no?
What?
I thought he still was performing on the ground.
No, he walked away. He walked away from the comedy. He might have been in that, but he walked away from all the big money and everything.
Yeah,
and then he came back.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, but that's, that's another kind of question, but unless you have that kind of passion, it's not going to make it.
No.
And part of the passion too, which a lot of the young comics, the open mic, mm-hmm. they go there and they don't prepare. I used to prepare about 4 hours for an open mic, for 5 minutes.
Really?
I would prepare 4 hours.
Wow.
I would pick out my routines. Mm-hmm. I would time it. I would change it around. I would perfect it. I would have it down mm-hmm. perfectly. I would know the amount of time that each joke took. Mm-hmm. So in other words, I would know one of them was 45 seconds, mm-hmm. one of them was a minute and a half, mm-hmm. and all of that. So I had enough time. Mm-hmm. Never go over the light. You know, that's
a goal.
That is not right. It's disrespectful, right. And you know, managers will fire you for that. You know, because they have another show, and
right.
you know, and all of that. And they want to sell another drink, and they want this thing to close at the same time.
Right.
Or you're screwing somebody else up.
Of time.
You're cutting their time.
Absolutely.
But I would have it, and I would rehearse that way. And of course, you know, very few people do that, but you have to do the work. You have to have that kind of commitment.
Yes. Well, I have that commitment, but I have a different process. It's sort of like that, but a little bit tweaked. So when I first go over to a mic, and actually it depends on how comfortable I am at the mic. If I'm not comfortable at the mic, I'm not even doing my jokes the way I'm going to really do them. I'm just sampling stuff, just putting it out there. And because I don't do, like some people, I was going to mic where people were stealing my stuff. That's why. So that was a problem for
you
me.
You were what? I'm sorry.
I was going to mics where people were stealing my stuff right in front of me. And say, Oh, then I was like, how do you know about that? And you're not even a black woman with an afro. How do you know about that kind of hair? Like, where'd that come from? So I started not doing my real stuff. I just do little bits here and there. So to someone else, it may seem like I'm not committed or whatever. I don't know. But I can assure you that I'm very committed. I just have a different process. You know, I say to each his own. I get the way you're saying. That's the way you're really supposed to do it. But unfortunately,
but part of it too is, you know, as you develop more of a persona,
right, then people know your voice.
They can't feel that much from you because it's so. With me, is of course it's easier, you know, the age and you know, and all of that, and I do play the age card. It's not the only part that I do, but it's a big part of what I do.
Right.
And so. It's hard for people to steal that, but I've had, you know, things I stolen, but it's a funny thing with stealing. You know, a lot of times, sometimes you're very definite. In other words, there's somebody there writing it down,
right,
and they use the same thing, right, and you've seen them before, you know it. Sometimes you can, two people can think of the same thing.
Yes.
And can have that. Now, I've had a couple of them.
I've seen that happen.
Which... I had one that Stephen Wright, who is just, he's one of my gods, the humorist. I had one which was not his that I came up with, which I had a Jehovah's Witness person came to my house, and I'm always very nice and all of that, and he gives me the book. And then he says, I'm going to come back next week and test you on it.
Yeah.
And as he left, I said, oh, my God, I got to get into a Jehovah's Witness protection program. And I just came up with it right there. You know, it was just – and I ran it by a lot of the things I have. I run by friends who I have two or three – one of them is my nephew, and a couple of friends who, if they laugh, mm-hmm. my jokes are going to be good. Mm-hmm. If they don't, they are just a thermometer or
right.
whatever the thing
right,
is
right.
for the open mic.
Gauge.
I mean, it saves me all the time.
Yeah.
And anyway, so I read this by you know, one of them. Brian Scott Doyle, I don't know if you know him, mm-hmm. And he's really, and he's always been very helpful to me. For example, if I use a term to make sure young people know it, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. I mean, you know, that it's hip with the younger generation and so on. Mm-hmm. So anyway, when I ran this joke by him, he said, it's okay, but it's not your finest hour.
Mm.
And so I kept it away, you know. I wasn't going to use it unless I had it in a group of jokes of a story.
Okay.
You know, I wasn't going to just, you know, Henny Youngman it. Right. So then I see Stephen Wright one night, and he was at the Paramount, and he was killing. He tells this freaking joke. It was the best joke of the night. It got the biggest laugh of all the other jokes. So you know, you never know. And I didn't hear it from him. It just came up on that term. Right. There's another one that I have with Lewis Black. It was the same way, that I made it up independently before I even heard him say it. Right. And then he said it, and I have even more fleshed out about it, right, about a nice Jewish boy and all that. Right. So it does happen.
Oh, yeah.
But not a lot of times it doesn't, obviously.
Right. Right.
And it's also possible that subliminally you could have heard it, yep, and you know, you forgot, and then you think you did. But so it is a big thing about the.
It was scary. I took a class and totally never got to perform, never got to do mics or nothing, because for my graduation, I performed at Caroline's. This is years, like 20 years ago. I don't know how many years, a thousand years ago. And I literally, after I went up, the headliner, whatever she was, went up next, and she took my whole set. I mean, literally, like someone lifted it. Everyone was looking like,
no kidding. Oh,
did
my
she
God.
Just, but she added the professionalism to it. You know what I'm saying? She added her twist, yeah, but it didn't sound right because it didn't sound like hers. That scared me so bad that I just never did anything again until now.
You know, when I took two comedy courses. So the second one was, you know, with a stand-up comic, Jim Mandrinos.
Uh-huh.
And somebody asked him, what do you do, you know, if somebody steals your joke? He says, I'll tell you what I did. He said, the first two times I wound up in jail because I punched the guy. And he said, since then, what I do is I go to his shows, I sit in the front, mm-hmm, and a millisecond before he says the punchline, I beat him to it, and I scream it out.
That's good. So, yeah. I like
it. But it's, you know, it's, and look at all the people. I mean, it's worse than rape as far as comics are concerned.
Yes,
you know, if somebody has a reputation for stealing,
yep,
you know, like they did with Amy Schumer.
Yes.
And I think Amy Schumer is a terrific comic. Mm-hmm. But they had they had 10 jokes there that they showed other people told, and then that that she told it. Mm-hmm. Now she said she didn't steal it. Somebody gave her the joke,
that's
and she
probably
didn't know
what really happened.
You know,
but
whatever.
That's her fault.
Whatever
for not
it is,
yeah,
it's a bad reputation.
Very
you know,
bad.
It's not. It's but
gotta check.
Yeah, it's difficult if you're not going to do your stuff.
Yeah, I don't see the point. I don't see the point when you get as. To me, when you get as big as Dave Chappelle or any of those guys and you've got people writing for you, to me, I don't respect them as much as I did when they were doing their own material. Because that's the whole point, is I want to hear your voice. And you can't run out of things to say.
Yeah,
you know
exactly.
What I'm saying? Like, it's
no,
weird.
It's...
Yeah, I'm weird with that. I'm weird. But
no, I just love that. And I used to do it, you know, the way, you know... they teach you in class,
right?
You know, every morning, you know, when you sit
right
there, and, you know,
minutes.
All that.
Yeah.
And I do that, but usually what it is, I find at night, mm-hmm, your guard is down more. As you're in the, about to fall asleep, you know, in between, and your guard is much lower. And that's when I come up with, you know, the kind of ideas and, I will just go and have a pencil and paper there and write it down.
Mm-hmm.
And but it can come to you anytime. And
right.
And
definitely, I keep a recorder.
There's nothing like it when you find a new joke.
Yes.
I mean, it's such good feeling.
Yes.
But you know, this is I love doing this. So
yes.
This is and I'm happier now than I was as a psychologist.
Right.
I
was going to ask you about that. We don't have much time left. Can you believe it? But I wanted to ask you something, and I didn't mean to cut you off. But I know your wife when you retired, you said something about her primary caregiver. Had a granddaughter or something, and she's the one that helped you get out of the bunk?
I had lunch with her today, her and her mother.
Oh, really?
She's a sweet young thing of 18.
Oh, she's 18 now.
And I was depressed taking care of my wife.
Of
she had dementia with Lewy body, and I was 24/7, and I gave more than my all.
Right.
I just gave everything, and I lost my sense of funny, and I had hoped to go to Caroline's, by the way, to take, I mean, that was the one school that I was going to go to, you know, after I retired,
mm-hmm,
I was going to do that, wow. And then my wife got sick and all of that. So, and I lost my sense of humor. Mm-hmm. And then one of the caregivers asked if it's okay to bring a daughter to work. She couldn't get a babysitter, and that was Charlene. Mm-hmm. And she was a smart little funny ass like me, like a smart ass. And we started riffing back and forth, and she was just... And all of a sudden, it all came back.
Oh, wow.
And because of her, I agreed to do I emceed for my friends' anniversaries.
Oh, nice.
The 25th, 30th, 40th, 50th, and 60th. And the 60th one was in the Hamptons. There were 100 people and all of that. Mm-hmm. And so out of my depression, I went there, and then I did so well, I said, I'm going to take another comedy course, and I got back in it at 79, almost 80 years old.
Wow.
And this little girl brought me back to life. God knows, I might have found my way later, but she brought back my funny.
Oh, that's amazing.
It just, couldn't be more pleased.
That is absolutely amazing. And would you give it? What advice would you give somebody if they did lose a spouse, or they have to deal with a spouse, or they're getting older, maybe they want to try this out? What advice would you give them?
If they lost their spouse,
yeah.
And what?
And they're trying to, and they want something to do, or they're thinking about comedy. Some people might be like, "Oh, it's too late," that whole thing.
Oh well, no. In terms of it's too late, it's never too late. Mm-hmm. Phyllis Diller started very late.
Yes.
Rodney Dangerfield, that's baloney. There's Mrs. Hughes that's around now. She is a panic.
Yeah.
And fantastic. So, that's BS.
Good.
So it's not the age, it's the matter of the life that you have in you and all of this. And I'm better now than when I was young. And I was funny when I was young, mm-hmm. but there's a lot more to me now more to give on to. I had more energy then, obviously.
Right.
I had more voice. I did impressions and songs and all that.
Yes.
And I can't do any of that, success. Well, I do parodies now, but I can't do, what I did before.
Right,
but,
right.
That was then, we're talking. But the thing is, when you retire, this is the advice I would give. Mm-hmm. Not everyone, but so many people had a passion that they had to put aside. Life got in the way. Mm-hmm. They had to make money and so on. When you retire, if it's dancing, if it's painting, if it's writing, whatever it is, you have a second chance. First of all, we live a lot longer now.
Yeah, exactly.
And so you're going to have that life.
That's why they gave us Corona.
What? Oh, yeah, yeah.
Make sure doesn't happen.
Yeah, I know. That gives you more time. So, that's no excuse. You can write that book you wanted to write.
Sure,
you have time. And, it gives you the time.
Yes.
And so that is the thing to do. No, and everybody, not everybody, I keep saying everybody, but so many people, there's another thing that they wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And just one thing, if I have time, Enter Laughing was on. Recently, Carl Reiner's movie.
Right.
And I saw it when I was 33. It was 1967. Mm-hmm. When I left that movie, I was crying. Mm. And why I was crying was, and here I was an established clinical psychologist. Mm-hmm. I had met the woman of my dreams. Mm-hmm. I had everything. Yeah, I mean, everything, important. Mm-hmm. But I didn't. I was missing. I had given up on comedy because that was so terrible to me when I got fired.
Okay.
That I just, my heart wasn't in it, unless I did it with my friends locally and so on.
Right.
So I was crying in the sense that in that movie, this putzy kid, he wanted to be an actor, not a comic, but it was the same kind of thing. And he just pursued it. And he went against his parents' wishes and to go to pharmacy school and all of this. Mm-hmm. And when I left that at 33 years old, I was crying because acknowledging that I had lost something. There was a void in my life, which I always felt as a psychologist, as successful as I was, as pleased as I was, I had lots of things.
Right.
But I never had that kind of comedy.
Right.
So when I came back at 80, and when I did my first show, and just did very, very well. Mm-hmm. And also, by the way, I was afraid of stage fright because I'm only great with my friends, but with strangers, I sort of uptight.
Right.
So I brought 51 of my friends to the show.
Good for you.
51 of my friends.
Good for you. You beat me. You beat me. I only bought 30 something, I think, 31 or
20. Yeah, well, but anyway, I never had stage fright after that.
Wow.
The second time I went on, I was cool.
Good
and since then, it's like I'm talking to you now. It was just, but I needed that first time.
Oh, wow.
And so it's just something that was there. And I'm so pleased how many people are doing what they wanted to do when they were 10 years old.
Yes.
I mean,
it's so important.
I couldn't be happier.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I'm happy that you got back into comedy because you're following your true passion, and it shows when you're on stage.
Your dream. Yep.
With your humor. We're running out of time, but I really appreciate you. Is there anything going on that we need to know about that you're going to be doing? Anything coming up?
Well, it's still on. I'm in the Mid-Hudson Valley finals,
right.
The comedy finals,
okay.
At Levity Live,
oh.
August 27th.
August 27th, Levity Live. Okay.
Thursday, August 27th.
Okay.
So far, they haven't canceled it.
Okay.
I don't know. The theater holds 350 people.
Yeah, they'll probably
so
do 150.
So they could space, you right, know, right. They could. So I have no idea what's going to happen.
All right.
And I hope so. And if I do, please, you know, the more the merrier.
Yes,
and,
that's right. We will be rooting for you all the way. Let us know.
And I hope to see you at Lucy's real soon.
Hopefully one day you'll see me soon.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you so much, George.
Okay.
You're the best. That was George Saltz, everybody.
Okay. Take care.
Bye. Thank you, guys. Make sure you tune in next week. And you can find this on YouTube, On the Town with Tanya. And check us out on Instagram and join.